Morning, Holy Star.
Morning.
You know, I just really thank the Lord today that we are all here. Because y'all could have stayed at home. It's not as bad weather that we're having today. But just give God a hand, clap of praise for what you need. Would y'all go with me in a word of prayer? God, we thank you today. We honor you today. We thank you for everything that you've done for us, for waking us up this morning, providing a way for us to get to church this morning. Hide me behind the cross so that your word and your Holy Ghost power can show through me and draw someone to Jesus today. In Jesus' name we do pray, amen. It's been a good time, y'all. See all of y'all for 6 months. I thank Pastor Thomas for allowing me to come up here and preach the word of God. I thank God for my mama, my brother that came with me today. Thank God for First Lady, the children, the deacons, musicians. Today, y'all, could y'all turn with me to the book of Matthew? I really enjoy my time. I hate this gonna be my last Sunday with y'all for a while. But I've enjoyed my time with y'all. Hopefully I won't be before you long today. I understand the pastor said somebody got some food back in the kitchen. Alright, Matthew chapter 7, we're gonna start reading with verse number 1. And it reads, "Do not judge so that you won't be judged. For you will be judged by the same standard with which you judge others. And you will be measured by the same measure you use." Verse number 3. "Why do you look at the splinter in your brother's eye, but don't notice the beam of wood in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the splinter out of your eye,' and look, there's a beam of wood in your own eye?" Jesus is speaking now. He says, "Hypocrite, first take the beam of wood out of your eye, and then you will see clearly to take the splinter of wood, the splinter out of your brother's eye." This morning, I want to talk to you from the topic, "Take a look in the mirror." Go ahead and take a look, but take a look in the mirror. Are you ready to see it in the presence of God?
That's good.
A mirror is defined as a reflective surface, typically glass, that reflects an image. Most of us have seen a mirror or used one before. Typically, I know when we wake up in the morning, we go to the bathroom, we turn the light on, we look in the mirror and we see our true self. We see ourselves without the makeup, without our hair being combed, without my alligator shoes, without my three-piece suit, without any Vaseline on my face. We see our, or even my plain plain. I ain't got nothing on right now, but we have some plain plain, don't we? And we see our true self. So now we go through this routine of getting ourselves together, right? We have to take a shower. We have to take our baths. Then we get out the bathtub and we put on our clothes, our lotion, all of this stuff. And we go back in the mirror to check to see what we're going to look like before we leave the house. But on rare occasion, some of us leave the house looking like how we woke up. Imagine doing that, and imagine while you're looking out and about, and you go to the store or any place, and you see somebody that you know. And now you're surprised, you're embarrassed, and you might feel a little exposed or caught because that person has seen you in a way that they have never seen you before. There was a similar situation situation that happened a few weeks back with a famous gospel artist named Kirk Franklin. Y'all know Kirk Franklin? The revolutionary in gospel back in the 90s and up to now, making wonderful gospel hits for us. One day, he was having a conversation with his oldest son, which is in his 30s. And while having that conversation, it began to get heated. You know, I know now that I'm grown, and we have parents, and parents have kids, and the children, they sometimes test the kids, right? For those of y'all that have children, they test you, right? And Kirk Franklin said a few choice words. Just a few. And but what Kirk Franklin didn't know was his son was recording him. The son went and put the piece of the conversation of him saying these choice words on the internet for everybody to see. And now I said, that's a little low down to put your own father out there like that. I know we as humans have flaws, but that wasn't right. Neither was it right for Kirk to say those words to his son, right? So now everybody sees the video. The video was now on Facebook, Instagram, the YouTube, other news outlets. And now Kirk Franklin has been exposed or caught in a situation. I saw the video and I said, I didn't get mad at Kirk Franklin because I know he's human. You know, we slip up sometimes, right? But what got me was these church folks and these comments. I expected the world, you know, to attack Kirk Franklin because he's supposed to be a man of God. But what I didn't expect was the church to attack him like that. They said this man was supposed to be a man of God. Why is he cursing? Why is he doing all this stuff? You know, I just couldn't get over that fact. I got angry at these folks. Like I said, I expected this from the world, but not from the church. The church shouldn't hurt folks like that. The church shouldn't say these things to our own believers, right? They were condemning this man because of what he did. And after that, I thought about a passage of scripture about judgment and how we have no right to judge other people because we have our own skeletons in our closet. Can I submit something to y'all today? If you want to write something down, write this down. The only difference between Kirk Franklin's situation and those church folks was the fact that they weren't exposed or caught. I bet because if we were exposed, then all of us would be down here at this altar crying to Jesus. Because we got our own stuff to worry about. We don't want anybody to know about some of our skeletons in our closets. That's why Jesus says in this passage, his first words, judge not. In the text, but in order to understand what this means, we need to understand what the word judge means in this sense. Judging is the standard in which we make what we believe is acceptable to us as we hold everyone else to a different standard while we don't follow that standard in which we set on other folks. That sounds just like a lot of church folks. But believers, in which I know many of us in here are, we don't judge folks, right? The church folks, they see nothing wrong with themselves. But try to judge people based on their appearance, what they've heard about them, or even what they already know about them. So Jesus says, since you want to judge folks like that, then you'll be measured by the same standard in which you set towards people. And I don't want that. I don't want my stuff to get out in the street when I go home to be the Lord. He said, oh, wait a minute, you was over here judging them. So by you judging them, I'm going to do the same thing to you. The Bible says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Now go ahead and just raise your hand and say, that's me. Because it is all of us, right? Point to yourself and say, self, take a look in the mirror. Going into this text now, it says, Jesus goes on in the text and tells folks, why do you look at the splinter in your brother's eye? But you don't notice the beam of wood in your own eye. You know, I was thinking about these church folks too. Now how they seem to want to put everything or every emphasis on somebody with an outward sin that they see or have been exposed, but won't even look to see what they've done. They don't want to see that. But believers take their situation, their testimony of what they've come out of, and help somebody else come out of what they already been through. Go ahead and point to yourself and say, take a look in the mirror. Jesus goes on and say, how can you say that your brother let me take the splinter out of your eye and look to see there's a beam in your eye? We got something that goes on. I know as Christians, we don't want our stuff to get out. We don't. Do you? See, we don't want our stuff to get out. So why do we use this finger? My pastor used this when he preached preaching on this morning. He said, well, you got one finger pointing at somebody else. You have four of them coming back to you. So we should be uplifting towards people, not judging them based on where they are, what they've done. Oftentimes, church folk will call out somebody else's sin and condemn them to hell faster than Jesus does and forget what they've done in the past. Which brings me to my second point. Don't get so caught up in the legalistics and the rules that you don't see the humanity of people. Don't get caught up in the legalistics and rules that you don't see the humanity in people. I know I'm going to get no amens right there. But as some of the church folks do, they get so tied up, and I did myself, in the church, in rules, in laws, in tradition, and all of this stuff. When we don't want to see other people doing wrong. It's a shame. We shouldn't be there. But believers don't do that. They work with people on the other side. Amen? We see this in John chapter 8, where Jesus saw a woman who was caught in the act of adultery. It's a very, very familiar passage. So it was saying, as Jesus was teaching, people began to gather and listen. These Pharisees, or people of this time who were known as the modern day church folk, they said, they brought this woman to Jesus, interrupted his teaching, threw her in the center, and said, and had been said, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. You know, when I was reading that, I said, what in the world are they doing catching this woman in adultery? So these folks had to be looking in on what that man and woman was doing in that room, right? So they said it was sin too. That was peeping tongues. I know, y'all. And according to the law of Moses, the Pharisees said, she should be stoned. Jesus ain't saying a word. He puts his finger in his sand and starts writing. They say, Jesus, what in the world are you doing? Jesus gets up, says, he's this famous line, he who is without sin, cast the first stone. He goes back down to the ground, starts writing back in the sand. Nobody said a word. And the scripture says, one by one, starting with the oldest, they began to leave that situation. Because they realized that they had their own skeletons in the closet. And they had to realize that they had to look in the mirror. Because they've seen the sin that they've done. They've seen they could have been caught. caught in the law and could have been stoned themselves, right?
Amen.
Right. Then Jesus got up from right and he said, where are your accusers? I'm paraphrasing. What did your folks say? They said you did something. And the woman said, Jesus said, have they condemned you? Jesus said, the woman said, no one, Lord.
Amen.
And Jesus did the example that we should follow. He was a believer. And he said, in my words, baby, I'm not going to condemn you. No sin no more.
Amen.
And that's how we should be as believers. I know most of us aren't like that, but there are some folks that judge folks so harshly that it turns them away from the church. And for our new believers, it turns them away from God completely. Because they say, if this is what a Christian is supposed to be, I don't want to be one. The word says that our tongue has the power of life and death. So our job is to speak life into people, despite what they are going through. Pharisees were ready to send this woman to hell. Mm-hmm. But Jesus said, take a look in the mirror.
That's right.
And take a look in the mirror at yourself and try, but before you cast judgment on anybody.
Right.
Because we've all done wrong, y'all.
Amen.
We have to humble ourselves. Jesus, he didn't judge us based on what we did or are doing, because he can bring us out of that thing, right? He showed this woman love and kindness.
Amen.
Just for a minute, imagine somebody walking, a young man walking in with probably his pants hanging down. And his underwear showing. Some people, they say, boy, pull your pants up in here. This is God's house. Rather than doing what the believer does and say, come here, young man, let me tell you something real quick. I know you might believe in, you know, sagging your pants, but please, just out of respect, in the house of God, could you just pull them up for me? Please.
All right.
That's how we should talk to people. Yeah. Not condemning them, not forcefully doing like these Pharisees did.
Right.
We have to be more like Jesus.
Right.
And I'm going to use myself as an example. I was one of those church folks. When Wright was out, I was in high school, coming and going into college. I saw, you know, when you're in college, you see things that, you know, God wouldn't approve of and says that are wrong.
Amen.
And in my mind, I said, these folks are going to hell for this. I was judging them on the spot. Wow. Didn't even know them. Wow. Didn't even encourage them to put a word in them that God had given me.
Right.
And God said, hold up, player. You got your own skeletons in your closet. You got your own going through. You cannot judge people based on what they're going through. That is his job. We have to be more like Jesus. And church folks are so easy to see what folks are doing wrong, rather than what God can do for them. What, rather than we can impart that God has given us into them. Which leads me to point number three. God sometimes has to use folk to check us. You know, after being in church for so long, we get on, some folks get on a high horse. And think too highly of themselves, and they ought to. And the Bible says you're not supposed to do that. And I got to that point too. I'm not perfect. I'm not going to be perfect down here. But with God, we will be. But I was judging folks. We can't do that. God has, it's a mindset, I believe, y'all. God has to change our mindset. We have to change our mindset and put our minds towards Jesus. There's a familiar story we all know. Back in 2 Samuel chapters 11 and 12, where you have David. Everybody knows David, the one that killed Goliath, the one that was anointed to be king. But David got caught too. He was on his palace in chapter 12. Y'all can read when you get home. He was supposed to be at war with other kings during that time in the spring, but he stayed home. Looked on this, got on his porch of his palace. He looked out, pulled them glasses down, and he saw a fine sister taking a bath on the roof.
Right here.
All right. So they say there's somebody right here. He said, hold on. help me with this. 10 plus 10 equals what, guys?
20.
There you go, $20. We got $20 on the board. 10 plus 10 equals 20. That is what believers do. Instead of criticizing, we help them. Church folks are quick to point out your flaws. But believers will introduce you to a man named Jesus. Y'all know this man. He died for us.
Right.
On one Friday evening.
Yes, sir.
He showed us two things.
Well,
one called grace and one called mercy. Grace is God giving you what you don't deserve. And mercy is God withholding what you deserve. And he gave this to us one Friday on a hill called Calvary. Yes, he did. But I come to tell you, we're almost in that season where they lifted Jesus on an old rugged cross. They hung him high and they stretched him wide. Yeah.